Hello, good evening. Welcome to Business Life. Coming up, Ghana to get first tranche of $300 million World Bank budget support funding in September this year, subject to meeting some conditions. We will hear from the bank's country director, Pierre Lapore.
It will be a three-year program for $300 million each, totaling $900 million over 3 years. Mm. And we expect, because the fund program will overlap the year after, we will put another 250. So we will put over the 4 years about 1.1 billion.
Two Chinese firms busted for non-issuance of VAT invoice. We will bring you details from the latest GRA VAT enforcement exercise.
I'm from Accra Area Enforcement. Yeah, your business fails to issue VAT invoice for transactions. We are arresting the management. So that's why we are here.
Plus, the cost of doing business is expected to go up following utility tariff hikes, which took effect today. Now, the Ghana Hotels Association is warning of a potential collapse of businesses.
We're trying to drive home the fact that it will certainly affect the business significantly.
We have details of these and many others lined up for you. Please stay. Always a pleasure to have you on. I am Pius Kojo-Baka. Straight to our very first story. Ghana is expected to get the first tranche of the World Bank budget support funding in September this year. Now, government could get about $3 million credited to its account, subject to meeting some conditions. The support is part of a $900 million that the World Bank will advance to Ghana as part of the IMF program. World Bank Country Director Pierre Lapore has been speaking on a yet-to-be-aired PM Express Business Edition tonight at 9 p.m. on the Joy News channel.
Up to now, we've only been doing project support, which is in line with what our country partnership framework. But with the reform in place, we've readjusted our pipeline, our list of projects coming, to factor in this budget support. It will be a three-year program for $300 million each, totaling $900 million over 3 years, and we expect, because the fund program will overlap the year after, we will put another 250. So we will put over the 4 years about 1.1 billion. I'll come back to that. Then, because of the effects of the fiscal consolidation, we've also brought in early on additional financing for social protection of 150 million, which is going to the board this month. So this will come early. Our budget support will come in the second half of the year. But we've also brought in a financial sector support project, as you know, with the domestic restructuring of debt, domestic debt. Yeah. These have impacted the banks. Yeah. The capital adequacy have been hit. And as we speak, most banks, if not all, are probably below the capital adequacy requirement. Yeah. And we are bringing in $250 million in emergency financial support project. To help central bank and government cushion the impact on the banks of liquidity, and we're focusing mostly on solvency issues. But I want to make an important point. We will continue to deliver our regular projects. For instance, now in this month, we will bring an agriculture diversification project to the board, 400 million. We will also bring additional financing of 150 for Great Accra Resilience Project. So we will continue to do our regular work. Mm.
Yeah. Let me try and focus on the budget support is it program thing, and that about $900 million. Yeah. Is that also before the board? When are we hoping that we could be getting the first tranche? Will that be dependent on, just like the IMF program, meeting some conditions or prior actions to ensure that those disbursements come in? Can you update us on that one, please?
Absolutely. Our plan, our hope, is we can bring this to the board by September. But it will all depend how fast we reach agreement with government on the prior actions. It may be September, it may slip in October. But we're hoping we need to do it this year, because IMF has factored in into its financing gap. You know, when IMF goes to the board, if there's a gap, they cannot go. So they factored in $300 million from the World Bank. But this $300 million, I want to be very clear, it's not acquired, it's not given, it's not taken that World Bank will come and give. We need to have a strong reform package from government that accompanies as prior actions for us to deliver this 300 million. And these have to be in areas where us and government agree. These are areas that have caused problems for the budget or for the sectors. For instance, I cannot go in all the details because we are still talking, where we feel we want to intervene in four pillars. One is the whole aspect of domestic revenue mobilization, which IMF also has some aspects because, you know, as we all know, Ghana's revenue GDP ratio is quite low, and we're hoping to accompany IMF reforms, government reforms to raise revenues. And there's a whole aspect around fiscal management, PFM, expenditure management. So we'll look at all these aspects. A second aspect is private sector development and financial sector. To accompany our financial sector project, we will also push for some reforms in the financial sector, because it's one thing to put money to address the problems now, but there are some long-term issues that still remain outstanding, and it will be important for Ghana to resolve, and we will support these reforms in that project. As I said before, when you have a kind of a very severe consolidation as you're having now, it's important to consider the growth agenda also. Because one thing is to squeeze the budget for you to realign and be able to pay your debt in the future, protect the poor, which we're doing through the social protection project, but also how do you keep the economy going? You need to maintain your growth agenda. You need to maintain economic growth, because the faster you grow, the faster the economy recover, your ratios of revenue will improve, your ability to pay your debt will improve, and the economy will recover faster. And we need to relook at, we want to discuss with government certain reforms in the investment climate, because what brings you FDI is a good, sound investment climate. And today, there are areas where Ghana needs to do more. But the other two, very quickly, is energy. As I've said before, we all know energy is a huge burden on the fiscal framework. Government is subsidizing the energy sector over $1 billion a year. And something needs to be done urgently. And I must say that, unfortunately, reforms in that sector have been slow. And we're hoping with the program it will accelerate. And finally, the whole issue of building resilience. We have a pillar that will address, bring support to build socioeconomic resilience, improve your social protection framework, because the World Bank may not always be giving money. Government, the budget has to be able to bring its own funding, the structures, the policies have to be there. And finally, climate.
All right, so you can watch the full interview tonight at 9 p.m. on the Joy News channel on PM Express Business Edition. Let's move on to some other stories. And the International Monetary Fund staff are expected in town later this month to track progress of Ghana's program with the fund. This will be the first staff mission after the country secured a program with the IMF in April this year. There is more in the following report.
This is not a review of Ghana's program, but interestingly, it is coming a few weeks after Ghana secured the 3-year program with the IMF. Staff want to use this visit to find out how the country is progressing on those structural and quantitative reforms that Ghana is expected to implement under this program. For some, this visit is very important because when the IMF staff carry out their first program review in September this year, or even November, they will use the end of June indicators to make a judgment on whether Ghana has passed its first review for the second tranche of funds to be disbursed to the country. There will also be some consultations with government on whether it is struggling to meet some of the conditions. The mission visit will also afford the IMF team an opportunity to embark on another round of engagement with organized labor and the Finance Committee of Parliament on Ghana's program to ensure that it get more stakeholder buying. The IMF staff will go to the board in November this year with its report on Ghana's program review. If it should pass that test, the board will go ahead and approve the second tranche of $600 million to be disbursed to government.
Now, two Chinese supermarkets are among six businesses that were busted by the enforcement and compliance team of the Ghana Revenue Authority for not issuing value-added tax invoice. Today's operation in the Ashaman and Tema metropolis focused on these firms that have not been issuing the Commissioner General's invoice. There is more in this report.
I'm from Accra Area Enforcement. Yeah, your business failed to issue VAT invoice for transactions in accordance with Section 41 of the VAT Act.
Which period?
The period is 22nd April 2023, in the year of our Lord. We are arresting the management. So that's why we are here.
The team from the Ghana Revenue Authority and the Criminal Investigations Department picked up two Chinese supermarket managers and four local retail operators who were busily serving customers at the time of their arrest. The move is part of continuous effort by the authority to mobilize revenue for the state. According to head of the team, Joseph Annan, these six persons will be made to pay higher penalties.
Business and all that, before we even go in to do the tax purchase. If you are with me, we've been to a few places and we've done a U-turn because I found a place to be too small. You understand? So if, and you see, when you are not registered and we pick you up, then your penalties are more than the one who is registered and not. Because then the audit takes you back to when you were supposed to have registered and you failed to do so.
In all, 19 persons have been picked up so far to face prosecution over the VAT infractions. Mr. Annan has hinted that two of the managers who were facing same charges were made to pay their penalties after audit.
The first 2 weeks, we have done the preemptive assessments. We've given them their bills and we pass them to immediately. And then the CID is also working on their statements. We also do our statements and give it to the CID because it's all part of the docket. So currently, that is where we have gotten to. Now, this very exercise is being done by all the area offices in Accra. All the area offices, the enforcement offices in Accra. I'm just coordinating the program.
Failure to issue the VAT invoice has denied the state of revenue to embark on certain government businesses.
Now, bulk oil distribution firms are downplaying the impact of gold for oil program on recent price reductions at the pumps. It comes on the back of the government's claim that the program has contributed significantly to price reductions in April and May this year. Dr. Patrick Ofori is chief executive of bulk oil distribution companies.
You'll check the total volume of product that we expect in the country. For their own issues and challenges, I don't think they've been able to do that. But also, to be fair to any businessman or any enterprise, you set up a year, you have your contracts with your international partners that runs into 2-3 years that you've already set this up. And then at the beginning of the year, they announced that 50% of the market is going to be cut off and reserved for the strategic reserve partner that you get levied to support. I don't think it's fair and it makes any business sense. Whereas all the regulatory charges, the license fee of the $300,000 that the BDCs are paying, they didn't bring in a caveat and say that, well, since we are cornering a percentage of your market share for a state entity, we want you to have some element of reprieve so that your license fee is also going to be scaled down 50% downwards. We've not had that. And I don't think if we really want to promote Ghanaian businesses and enterprises, such deliberate decisions should not have to go against the private sector, whoever is investing in that. But the issue of whether they should do the 50% and other things, I don't think any of our members plan their businesses based on bus or tours, operational efficiencies or inefficiencies. And clearly, some of the current challenges that we are having on the port basically is as a result of bus biting more than they can chew.
You're still watching Business Life with me, Pius Kujo Baka. We've got more for you after this break. Hello, welcome back. The cost of doing business is expected to go up once again following utility tariff hikes which took effect today. Water and electricity tariffs are up by 18% per unit. Some businesses have complained that this could worsen their plight as they are already struggling with high taxes and inflation. Some hotels have indicated that these hikes could lead to the collapse of the operations. Dr. Edward Akanyamike Jr. is the president of the Ghana Hotels Association.
What we're trying to drive home is the fact that it will certainly affect the business significantly. And we are looking at it against the events of the past few months in relation to utilities. As we speak, the PURC is yet to resolve the astronomical increase that it places in for the 1st February upward adjustment of 167%. And from the information I'm getting, it doesn't look like it's something that they want to resolve. Now, when you get to electricity too, that one, there are no issues with that astronomical increase. But of course, since September last year, there's been that upward adjustment periodically. What it means is that, like you rightly said in your intro, the cost of doing business is going to go high. Now, it simply means that the rates that we keep complaining about, which our clients and customers, both domestic and internationally, keep complaining about, is still going to go high. And that certainly is also going to affect patronage. And that is where our concern is. We will, unfortunately, we have no choice but to get our customers to also share in that increment.
To some other stories, the National Insurance Commission is encouraging informal sector businesses to take advantage of enhanced insurance policies to increase their participation and benefits. The informal sector employs about 80% of the country's working force. Ashanti Regional Manager of the NIC, Farouk Dramani, believes increased enrollment in insurance policies will help keep the informal sector businesses afloat. He spoke at the launch of Prudential Life's insurance policy cover for informal sector players in celebration of the company's 175th anniversary. Love FM's Nana Bwachi Adom has more in the following report.
Insurance penetration in Ghana remains low despite enhanced drive. Apathy is high among players in the informal sector, though they constitute a high percentage of the country's labor force. Some businesses have suffered due to failure to insure against accidents. The Ashanti Regional Manager of the National Insurance Commission, Farouk Dramani, is calling for attitudinal change among the informal sector players.
The commission is very much in support of what we call micro insurance, because today in Ghana, the working force, 80% of the working force of Ghana are in the informal sector. And that is why micro insurance is very important, so that the informal sector is roped into the insurance sector so that they can also have insurance policies to take care of their needs.
He spoke at the launch of the Prudential Life's Mekakrawa insurance policy, which is set to include unbanked, wholesale and medium earners of all classes. The policy is geared towards ensuring financial inclusivity among Ghanaians, particularly from the informal sector. According to the CEO of Prudential Life Insurance Ghana, Dr. Hazel Barat, the Mekakrawa insurance policy is to support every Ghanaian to make the best out of life no matter how much one earns.
So you can be paying pieces of 40 every month to have cover and protection against four critical illnesses. Right, so that's how we've evolved this product to do good on Ghana market in terms of how we listen to people, understand them and deliver on helping them achieve their best in life. So that's our purpose in Prudential Life. What are the we have stroke, we have kidney disease, liver disease,
Kejetia Marketing Tomahima, Nana Yabwedu, encourage the informal sector to take advantage of the opportunity.
Not long ago, a part of the market got burnt. We know if these policies were in existence, it would have helped some of our people. I am encouraging all our traders to get involved.
Joy News, Nana Bwachi Dankwayadom, reporting.
Now, internal auditing must be seen as a critical tool to help Ghanaian businesses to grow beyond their owners to become African giants. This is an assertion by partner and head of advisory at KPMG Ghana, Andy Akoto. According to him, the challenges of many businesses in Ghana can be linked to the absence of good controls through internal auditing in the operations. Mr. Akoto was speaking to Joy Business after a panel discussion to climax the Internal Audit Awareness Month.
Internal Audit Awareness Month is dedicated to celebrate internal auditors and their impact on business growth. Under the theme, Revitalizing the Role of Internal Audit for Sustainable Growth, the panel delved into mechanisms to make enterprises survive the current disruptions in the economy and the important role of the internal auditors. KPMG and the Institute of Internal Auditors are organizing this for the second time. Head of Advisory and Partner at KPMG, Andy Akoto, believes that having good internal control systems can prevent businesses from collapsing in the early stages.
Naturally, internal audit must be seen as a strategic partner to build multi-generational businesses in the context of Ghanaian enterprises. Because what we find very brilliant enterprising entrepreneurs giving birth to businesses, but once they are no more, for whatever reason, those businesses fail to thrive after them. Internal audit can help deal with this kind of situation because it will examine all matters of governance, sustainability, succession planning, talent acquisition, and bring an objective and independent view to how to continue to enhance the business, add effective controls, and ensure that everyone is accountable for the reason why they are part of the enterprise.
Speaking on the same topic, Deputy Managing Director at GCB Bank, Emmanuel Odate Lamte, stressed the need for internal auditors to identify risk around business and act timely.
There are a number of areas which I'll say internal audit is critical to driving sustainable business. Typically, you do find in many institutions traditional risk areas like market risk, credit risk, operational risks tend to get a lot of focus. But strategic risk, risks around the long-term sustainability of the business or existence of the business, tends to be pushed back. And this is why I think that internal audit with the expertise are able to connect the dots across many aspects of the bank and then challenge management, lead with questions on matters relating to strategic risk.
The event was climaxed with awards for some deserving staff and a cake-cutting ceremony.
And before we go, malaria is estimated to cost the country about 1 to 2% of GDP and businesses about $6.58 million annually. To this end, private sector players have been urged to integrate the fight against malaria into the operations and, of course, health strategies to help eradicate malaria by 2030. Speaking at the launch of the Zero Malaria Business Leadership Initiative, Minister of Health Kwiku Ajimanmenu called for more collaboration to end malaria by 2030. Here is more. The Zero Malaria Business Leadership Initiative aims to harness the power of businesses to drive impactful solutions, create sustainable financing mechanisms while implementing innovative interventions to eliminate malaria by 2030. Speaking on behalf of the Minister of Health at the launch of the initiative, Special Advisor to the Minister of Health, Dr. Bafwe Wa, said the collective resources and expertise of the private sector are crucial to eradicating malaria by 2030, as well as ensuring a conducive environment for sustainable business growth.
In Ghana, malaria is the number one cause of outpatient department attendance and is a major cause of hospital admissions. Malaria is a significant financial burden on our national health insurance scheme.
We shall bring you more on this later at Prime Business here on the Joy News channel. I am Pius Kojobaka. Thanks for watching.